Okay, so this will be the short version. Of course, I encourage everyone to take a look at the extended version. It's much more detailed. But for those of you who don't have much time, let's go for the short version. So, Stockfish versus Komodo. Stockfish is now the strongest chess playing entity in the universe, basically. And it was playing Komodo here. And they went for a Grand Prix. So, e4, c5, knight c3. This is the close Sicilian. And now d6. This is one variation of the close Sicilian. Now f4, this is basically the Grand Prix, and knight c6. We can see here that Stockfish evaluates this as slightly better for black, but it's basically equal. Knight c6, knight f3, and g6, going for the fianchetto variation. The fianchetto variation, white gets good queens, kingside attacking chances, but black also has its chances in the center and on the queen side, and this bishop bears down heavily on the queen side, so that's one of the ideas of the black setup. Bishop c4, bishop g7, standard maneuvers. The bishop could also come to b5, but c4 is usually more common. Hitting f7, so this structure, this fianchetto structure, makes f7 weak, so we hit it with bishop f7. d3, standard development move, trying to get the bishop out and later connect rooks. e6, now this is planning a later d5, which we will see in the game. Castles, and knight g7, this further supports d5. And now queen e1, this prevents d5 tactically, because if d5 is now played, e takes, and now you can safely capture here, because the knight can't take back, because it's pinned. You notice the queen lining up with the king. And if castles, a3 is also possible here, but a6 is played to play b5, and after bishop b3, play knight a5, and this cramps the black, the white queen side, and wins the bishop pair, and also the very important light square bishop, which again is attacking this weak fianchetto structure on the light squares. So white prevents this b5, knight a5 idea with a3. Now the bishop can retreat, and after castles and bishop a2, which preemptively gets out of the way of d5, so it's a prophylactic move. And after this, we have d5 anyway, and knight e2. And this position, I mean, it's sort of equal, maybe slightly favorable to black, but soon we will see how Komodo goes astray. So knight e2 aims to maneuver the knight to g3, and we will see later how important this move is. And it also gets out of the way to be able to play c3, d4, e5, which is a very important point, because if white is able to achieve this kind of structure, so he locks the center down, then he's able to better play a kingside attack, because when the center is closed, it's easier to conduct a wing attack, like a kingside attack or a queenside attack. So that's what white aims to do. He wants to close the kingside and a5. Already this is a step in the wrong direction. Here c4 by Komodo was necessary. You can see c4 here. And this weakens this complex on the light squares, and basically gives black equality. Now a5, it's also a good idea because it's also on the queen side. So c4 is another move. So white wants to close down the center with these moves, these pawn moves, and then attack on the king side. So how does black counteract? He counteracts on the queen side. So c4 is also an idea because it counteracts on the queen side, but it's a better idea than a5, which does also gain space on the queen side, but it's weaker because it really doesn't attack the central majority here. So this is what c4 does. And a5, in contrast, also wants to play bishop b6, bishop a6, where d3 will be under pressure. But really, this pressure is superficial, because even though you can't go c3 immediately, because the bishop on a6 would take it, you still have the d1 square, so you protect the pawn on d3 with the rook from d1, then you go c3, d4, e5, and you achieve the break anyway. So b6, bishop a6 is a bit of a superficial idea, and it costs Komodo the game, basically. Or it's one of the reasons that led to its demise. And actually, in this game, usually it's quite clear why the engine went astray. But here, just Komodo gets slowly outplayed. It's like watching a game between AlphaZero and Stockfish, except in this case, Stockfish is AlphaZero and Komodo is the Stockfish. yeah. So e5, closing the center as we said, b6, of course aiming for bishop a6, and now bishop e3. Now we also see the point of d3 in the opening, you just want to develop the bishop, and now you are better able to connect the rooks, and the bishop avoids, sorry, that was a misclick. So bishop e3 also avoids some checks on this diagonal with the queen, like going to b6, but yeah, it's mainly just to develop, and maybe later bishop f2, bishop h4 can be played, which is an idea in the Stonewall defense, and also the Stonewall attack, where you maneuver your dark square bishop as such, and if it's the defense, you maneuver the light square bishop as such. And now bishop a6, again putting pressure on d3, so now the point is revealed. You can't go c3 because d3 would hang, but you can, later we see Stockfish goes for rook d1, and then c3, d4 is played anyway. Anyway, g4 now. It was better here to go for queen c8, queen d7, sorry. And now g4 is more difficult to achieve because g4, after you play something like f5, and so I actually have this here, f6 or f5. And now after takes and takes, now if you move the bishop, as would happen in the game, now e6 is well protected. But in the game, after g4, if you go for f6 here, e takes, rook takes, and now bishop d2, now we have tremendous pressure on e6, because as you notice, there are no defenders on e6 after the rook is removed, while in the previous variation here, there are three defenders on f6. Well, the rook will be removed anyway, so there are two defenders. So 2-0. So that's why it was critical not to play bishop a6 here, but instead play queen d7. But anyway, bishop a6 was played, again going for this superficial idea. And white pauses on that mistake by going g4, and now the kingside attack starts rolling. And notice, of course, that white doesn't go for queen h4 immediately, because that would be met with knight f5, forking these two pieces, and also threatening to trade queens, but it fails tactically because of the fork. So g4 prevents knight f5 and gains kingside space and allows later an f5 to take place. So queen d7, this is little too late, and actually it puts the queen in an awkward spot, even though it connects the rooks, but it puts the queen in an awkward spot because after knight g5, and if the f-pawn were to move and the d-pawn were to move, the bishop here on can take on e6, and these pieces are lined up, so it's a fork. So if you can imagine that these pawns were removed and the knight were on g5, then this bishop taking here would fork these two pieces, the king and the queen, which would be terrible. Now queen g3, so the queen from this maneuver with queen e1, queen h4 is very typical for the Grand Prix. Here instead queen g3 is tried, later queen h4 will be played. Queen g3 just gets the queen closer to the king side and furthers white's attack. F6 is tried, F5 was also possible, but Komodo seems to think that since it's closed position, F6 or F5 won't matter. And here after rook F2, which is a brilliant move, shifting the rook over to G2, and so getting the rook lined up with the king on the G-file, F5 is played, which is somewhat of a waste of a tempo by Komodo, but seems to think that since this is a closed position, it won't matter, but it ends up mattering. H3, of course, here you don't close up the king side with g5. You go for h3, so if you capture, you take back, and then you have the open h-file to use, and you've bolstered your center. So rook ac8 is already a step in the wrong direction. Here, Komodo needs to play rook ae8 and knight d8 later on to overprotect e6, then d4, and then bishop b7. So to get what I'm saying, let's take a look at rook ae8. So if queen h4 here happens at knight d8, now after, let's say, like rook d1, you can play d4 here and bishop b7. Earlier you couldn't play d4 because knight g5 would hit. So let's say, do I have it somewhere? Yeah, okay, so let's say after queen h4 you go for d4 immediately. Now there's knight g5, and these two points are attacked. So you either, what I said earlier about bishop takes e6, forking, now it's check, bishop takes e6, check, forking the queen and rook. This is what happens here. And you're threatening mate also, so you have to cover the mate with like h6, and then bishop takes e6 is played. and you win the queen. So this is what happens here. That's why it's critical to overprotect e6 first with knight d8. And of course, get the rook here so that it's not over there, not doing anything. And also, it supports the e6 square anyway. And now after, let's say, like rook d1, now you can play d4 and black basically equalized. But Komodo anticipates opening up the file with rook ac8 and c4 later on. But it doesn't work because, again, these threats are more powerful. So queen h4. Now going for knight g5, and you can see the point of knight e2 earlier. Now it wants to go to g3, and the rooks will shift over to the g file or h file, but the g file in this game is seen, and the bishops will load back like snipers, where they cannot be attacked by any of black's knights. It's crucial that they load back, but of course you need to move this rook before loading back these two bishops, so it doesn't get stuck on a1, not doing anything. Use all your pieces, of course. And this means that white will basically win. Bishop b7, I mean, the bishop was here attacking d3, so putting it back on b7 is a very bad idea, because you're just straying away from your main purpose of playing the move. So again, Komodo seems completely lost, and now c3 intending to lock up the entire center with d4, then going for a big kingside attack. And this is what happens now. Rook g1 lining up with the king, bishop a6, again putting pressure. But rook d1 anticipates that pressure. Actually, rook d1 here was a brilliant prophylactic move. And now knight a5, rook g2 lining up, bishop a6, and now knight g3, as we said before, the knight would like to go to g3. King h8, and now d4 finally, closing up the center. Note that at any point if black recaptures on d4, we don't take back with the pawn, because that would justify the rook c8 move. We take back with a piece. And now the rook is completely dead on this open file. So rook c7 is tried to defend along this rank. So rook c7 tries to defend along this rank. But then knight g5 is played. And we get to see these two points again. H6. Now knight f3 wasn't strictly necessary, but it's played. Because now we'll just maneuver these pieces as such. And get a winning attack. And this is exactly what happened. The bishops are loaded back like snipers so that they don't get harassed by black's pieces, especially the knight on a5. This knight will harass these two bishops, so you load them back. And now queen e8, king h2. The point of king h2, of course, is to bring the rook to the g-file, which is what happens. Queen f8. And now finally you open up the position when all your pieces are lined up. Look at the harmony of all these pieces. So they're all lined up to attack the black king. Knight g5 making use of the pin. You can't take it because your king is pinned. And e6 threatening knight f7. And of course e6 is protected by the knight, so the rook can't take it. And now bishop f6. And finally knight f5. Also knight f7 check was possible, but knight f5 is even stronger. So if g takes f5, you check. And here, of course, if queen f7, you have queen h6. And this line. And if king h7, you just take the rook, the bishop, and you're completely winning with a mating attack. And if knight takes f5, you just take the knight, and you also win with knight f7 in the same way. So bishop takes g5 here after knight f5, so you can't take like this or like this. And like this you can't take because it's pinned. So the only other recapture is bishop g5, which is tried. And now fg5. Again, if... So fg5 is played, you just take back, and now h5 is played. If knight f5 here, you just take, and if takes, you just take here, which is mate. So fg5, h5 is played, and not knight f5, as we had seen. So h5, rook f2, now this lines up with the queen, and basically, no, this isn't what happened, sorry, I need to remove that. Rook takes e6, removing the pawn, but then comes knight d6, threatening to go to f7, and of course if the rook captures knight, we capture the queen with a winning, material on our side, and we also get a crushing attack. We also have a crushing attack. So queen g7, actually in the game what happened after knight d6 was queen takes f2 check, and here actually Komodo played the move and resigned. So it saw that it was completely lost. Of course, this is nothing. You just take back and you're I'm completely winning with this attack. Here probably just queen f7 should win, or any other move really. And after queen g7 as a sample line, we can just check. And if king h7 actually, we take here, making use of this pin, so you can't take because the bishop is lined up with your king. And after queen h6, the only move you take here, and it's checkmate. So brilliant attacking game by Stockfish. And actually, funnily enough, Komodo didn't do anything. It was stuck on the queen side. It didn't do anything useful. It missed c4 early on, if you remember. Here, instead of a5, it missed c4. And it missed h6 at some point. So, it should have played h6 at some point in the game. And it should have overprotected e6 and gone for d4 and bishop b7, which would have basically equalized. So, here we can see this line. Of course, not d4 immediately because of g5. So you overprotect first, then d4, d4, and bishop b7. And so it missed many key defensive ideas, and it basically played like complete trash, to be honest. Well, Stockfish made it look like that. Of course, if I were facing Komodo, or Carlsen were facing Komodo, we would get completely trashed. But even in this exact position, let's say, if you gave this position to me or Carlsen, or anyone, I mean just any human being, you'd get completely crushed by Komodo. But Stockfish made it look really easy, and for good reason. Komodo was playing without a plan. Okay, so that's it for the short version of the video. I hope you can see the extended version. Okay, so as a summary for this video, well, Komodo didn't react quite well to Stockfish's kingside attack. It just moved pieces around on the queenside, and it didn't play out a proper plan. And the proper plan was to, of course, overprotect e6, then push through with d4 and get the light squared bishop on b7. So you overprotect e6, so there's no knight g5, bishop e6 kind of ideas. And Komodo also missed key liberating moves, like c4 destroying the central pawn mass, which is very important in the Grand Prix, you should always remember that. h6 protecting against knight g5, which may or may not be a weakness, but usually it's not a weakness, but you need to use your positional judgment to know. And overprotecting a6 and defending with d4, which we talked about. And rook a7 laterally defending against kingside threats. We'll see why in the application novel settings why this is a very important idea. And earlier queen d7 and keeping the bishop on c8 to overprotect e6. This makes g4 less powerful, so it would have basically prevented g4, which was one of the moves that won Stockfish the game. And Stockfish went for a brilliant piece rearrangement. It put the bishops back like snipers on c1 and b1, where they cannot be attacked by black's knights. And put the knight on g3 and the knight on f3, and the knight on f3 went to g5. And the queen on h4, which helped attack, and the rooks were lined up on the g-file, which also opened up and basically killed black. So, yeah, that's it for the summary, and now let's head over to the key concepts. Okay, so the key concepts for this video. Well, first of all, you need to react to your opponent's plan. You can't just sit around and do nothing, and you should ask yourself, how does my opponent want to rearrange his or her pieces? That makes knowing his or her plan easier. So if you knew where Stockfish's pieces were going, you would have overprotected e6 and went for d4 and bishop b7. Close the center to make wing attacks possible. This is what Stockfish did to make the kingside attack possible, and this is what Komodo should have done to make the queen side attack possible. And c4 is a very important idea in the Grand Prix, always remember it. It breaks down the white center and helps a lot in getting equality, achieving equality, equalizing. And when being attacked on the kingside, you can't just sit around with no plan. Defend, attack on the queen side, and or open up the center with d4, do something. You can't just sit around and wait for white to destroy you. Don't do that. So application and novel settings. We're going to take a look at this game, which by transposition reached the same position. Here queen e1 first was tried. The queen e1 is actually the move order in the game. But now a6, a3, okay, so still following the game. And now h6. Okay. So, actually, there was no transposition. This just followed the game to the T. And now h6 is again an interesting move because it blocks knight g5, but at the same time, it allows these kinds of sacrifices. So, black needs to be careful, but at least here he's actually doing something, not like the game we saw where Komodo just sat back and enjoyed the sun. b5, it's a move I like. The low depth stockfish prefers b6, but b5 is an excellent idea, aiming to go for queenside counterplay, which again Komodo didn't go for. Queen g3, okay, maybe bishop e3 is stronger to better control d4, but okay, queen g3 is also possible. Now castles. Perhaps here the engine wants to go rook a7. Again, a very interesting idea. Defending like this, another idea to remember. This is one thing Komodo missed as well, rook a7. But castles happened, f5, the classic pawn sacrifice, and now this. And now, yeah, maybe h5 kind of blocks things up. But for some reason, black went for b4. B4, and this allowed takes. Here, knight d5 would have been very strong, and the main line is bishop e6, because if takes, you just take back, and you're threatening this knight. So let's say he takes, and bishop d7, now you have knight g6 utilizing the pin. So knight takes g6, rook f8, knight h4, and maybe knight d4 sacrificing the rook there, or the exchange, or this, and actually here this is maybe stronger. Knight d5, the main line after bishop e6 is takes, and here also you're doing quite alright. Up an exchange, but white decided to go for bishop h6, so here probably h5, and there's no attack by white. So h5 and you go knight d5, and this position should be around equal after the bishop e6 we saw. At b4 and takes, and now knight g5. This doesn't work, not because of what was played in the game, but because of c takes b2. As you can see, the game is filled with mistakes, and this is great. This means that black is doing something if the game is filled full of mistakes. If black just sat back like what Komodo did, the human would completely destroy black. But here something happened. So here c takes b2, and let's say rook ab1 is played, then d5, and again the king escapes, and black is doing alright. And if bishop takes g7, you also escape. This is one ridiculous line. And the king is safe here on e5, which is quite surprising, but it is. So the move here was c takes b2, so you force the rook to go to b1, and then you play d5, but d5 immediately was played, and after takes, here, yeah, just rook here to prevent c takes b2, now this happened, and now this move is a little bit too late, because there's knight f6 now, in contrast to the position before. Here there's no knight f6, now there's knight f6, and this doesn't work, simply put. And white doesn't have enough for the sacrifice material. So you see what Najdic did here? He didn't play that accurately even, but white didn't either. And that's because there was some tension, there was some, kind of back and forth. This is for human play, but I mean engines, it's the same thing for engines. Like if Komodo would have tried h6 here, or it would have played b5 or rook a7, again, we're making use of these concepts. Like here, if Najdic watched my video, he would have found the rook a7 instead of castles. Am I right? So yeah, it's these concepts that we can apply in different settings. And it's the same concepts in the Grand Prix. So yeah, this is how we'll apply these concepts. Okay, so for our fun fact, DRGN1 or Dragon1 is a peptide synthesized to resemble a Komodo dragon peptide. It's created by Komodo dragons, which promotes wound healing. This peptide promotes wound healing against S. aureus, so it might prove beneficial in the fight against antibiotic resistance. So thanks a lot, Komodo dragons. You're very helpful animals. Okay, for the future consideration section, first of all, why is 9A3 not played as often? In other positions in the, not specifically this position, in other positions in the Grand Prix, it should be played more often as well, in my opinion. And what was the cause of Komodo's lack of plan? Maybe this needs to be checked by the Komodo team. Obviously, we who don't have access to the source code won't know. And finally, a biological question, how will we fight antibiotic resistance? Will DRNG1 prove to be the peptide that kills off all antibiotic resistance? Will it be a useful step in the right direction? Okay, and that's it for the video. Thank you very much for watching. I hope you got something out of it.